Blackstone Audiobooks presents Love in a Dry Season by Shelby Foote. Part 1. Chapter 1. The Barcrofts. Major Malcolm Barcroft was 67 when he died, the last male of his line. Accompanied as it was by word of his daughter's peculiar reaction, the announcement of his death caused people to remember many things about his life which they otherwise might have forgotten, as is usually the way in the formality of getting a man of property buried and awaiting the reading of his will. He was an institution in Bristol, one of the final representatives of what the town had progressed beyond. Winter and summer he wore dark suits and pleated bosom shirts with a pearl stud and plain gold cufflinks and a snub bow tie. When he stood alone or walked about for his evening constitutional, he gave an impression of height and stiffness. High-stomached, negroes called him. But when he was juxtaposed among other men, you saw that he was not really tall, and that his shoulders were even a bit stooped. He wore a rimless pince-nez from which a length of fine chain dropped like a golden cobweb to a spring button at his left lapel. His mustache and roached hair were iron-gray, and his nose was like a blade between flat cheeks, sallow from recurrent malaria, and burning brown eyes. Lightly grizzled, his eyebrows were tufted at their outer ends, giving him a somewhat Mephistophelian air. This was belied, however, by a soft voice and a courteous old-world manner. He was born in Reconstruction times, 1873, 2 months after his father, who had been a Confederate officer and had come home one-armed from the war, was killed in a scuffle over a ballot box with one of Governor Ames's imported election officials. Reared by his mother and a maiden aunt, Malcolm was willful and impetuous and domineering, until the two women, taking the advice of an uncle, gave it up and packed him off to military school in Tennessee. There he found interests worth his talents, studies of campaigns more complex than those involved in outwitting two admiring but rather terrified female relations, and he settled down with unexpected seriousness. He was impatient during vacations at home, reading military biographies, Jomini and Badeau, for which he drew sketch maps to follow the battles and entered his objections in the margins, usually with exclamation points and cross-references to sustain him. He cultivated the habit of saying, "Good, good," as Stonewall Jackson was said to have done, and of raising one hand palm forward from time to time, also as Jackson was said to have done, to implore divine guidance, according to some, or merely to slow the flow of blood and thereby ease the throb of the wound he had taken at First Manassas, according to others. Malcolm took all this quite seriously, and if it sometimes had its ridiculous aspect, he, at least, was never conscious of it. In his final year at the Tennessee school, he was appointed cadet captain and had decided definitely on an army career. His life seemed to stretch out before him in agreeable vistas, brilliant forays on the frontier, punctuated with periods of tedious but glittering staff duty in Washington, and perhaps, if the Germans and Spaniards continued to bluster, a real war to lodge his name in the history books, or at least in the tactics manuals. To these last, he brought an enthusiasm and appreciation which some young men his age were devoting to Keats. He found them exciting, and not only for their subject matter. The language itself enchanted him. The mission of the infantry in attack, as defined by the text, to close with the enemy and destroy him, had a wild, triumphant, almost lyric beauty, while the mission of the infantry in defense, to maintain the integrity of the position, was nothing less than the finest phrase in literature. His scalp would tingle when he read such things. The hair on his neck would bristle. But just 3 weeks before commencement exercises, he received a letter in which the family stationery was puckered with little blisters where his mother's tears had dried. The gentleman left in charge of his father's estate, a lawyer, a friend of the family, had absconded, gone to Texas, the letter said, with what little was left after hopeful but feverish mismanagement. So when the final dress parade was over, Cadet Captain Barcroft packed his trunk, folding in the gaudy uniforms with the unblooded sword and the paper-backed texts, of which no future edition would bear his name, and came home to Bristol to enter his bachelor uncle's cotton office. He renounced the dream of pomp and glory, the study of evolutions of the line and the finer points of precedence, and undertook the study of staple values and fluctuations in the cotton market. Within 3 years...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.